This is Alan Stewart with B&B Yacht Designs, and I've got a sneak peek of a new 3D model. This is the Class Globe 580, designed by Janice Madursky for Don McIntyre, who's putting together a new class called the Class Globe 580. And we are excited to be working on this project with him. This is the 3D model that we've been working on for the boat, and we're going to be putting together a kit for this boat. And more information is going to be available on their website, classglobe580.com, where you can see where to purchase the kit and you can read more about this boat. But we're really excited about the design and excited to be working on this project.
Well, g'day. This is another live for us. I think this is the number three. I'm not sure. I had been threatening to bring in some of the builders and talk to them, but we've been too busy to do that. But later on, in a few weeks, we'll get some of the builders on here. So if you've got a question while you're doing this, you can put it in the comments. I'll see it. And something's definitely working with the Globe 580 at the moment, because there's zero questions for this live session, which is fine. We've got a lot of things happening with the builders group on Facebook. The biggest one is the forum, which I'll talk about a bit more in a minute. We've got a 580 forum you can access from the website. And there's a lot going on there. There's some really cool stuff, a lot of interesting questions and people making comments and suggestions. We get a lot of feedback, so that's kind of cool as well. Anyway, the first thing you may have seen, the first thing I get into, you may have seen this interesting picture here. It's actually one of two boats that sailed across the Atlantic. It's a Setka design. It's a Setka, one of the original Setkas from Janice Madursky. And this picture's off his blog. Now, I want to really say, anyone that's interested in building a 580, the original blog that Janice wrote covers a lot of things. It was building the first Setka, the very first one, and it also goes through the whole process of preparing for his trip, right, he and another guy. And in fact, an interesting side point here, this, well, in fact, I'll come back to them in a minute. So get onto that. There's a link to it on the forum. So you just go to the website, go Globe 580 forum, and it's one of the first subjects that's up there now, because he also goes into the handling of the boats at sea going across the Atlantic. There's some amazing build stuff, like talking about keels and so on. I've got some photos here. Just simple things like actually drilling, you know, the bulb onto the plate, casting the bulb in your backyard, building your own mast. Like, you built the mast out of a raw section. It was very basic and simple. So it really just gives a lot of encouragement to the idea of doing it yourself. I mean, you can, you know, the 580 is a little bit more sophisticated, say, than the Setka, but you can still do everything yourself on a 580 if you really want to. The other interesting thing about this picture, which I love it, it's they've launched the boat. They've basically taken it off the trailer, put it on the side, set the mast up on this launch ramp, and they're going to wait for the tide to come in. While they're doing that, you can see the keel plate there. It doesn't have the bulbs on it, but the one half of the bulb you can see right next to the keel plate. There's the rudder there, sails wrapped on a boom. So they'll bolt the plate on, then they'll bolt the two halves of the bulb on, and then wait for the tide to come in, float it, and they're off. And so it was a very interesting trip, to say the least. That was 2012. Two of them. Now, this boat was owned by a guy called Simon. Simon's, he's a Polish sailor, and I think it's Simon's Krasinski, who was the who went on to do another two solo voyages around the world after he went across the Atlantic on this. I may be wrong because Janice just refers to him as Simmons, but he looks the same. So after they did the Atlantic, if it is the same guy, he got another small 22-foot yacht and did a two-year solo circumnavigation around the world, stopping, like it was a solo cruise, you might say, but really efficient. And then a year or so later in the same boat, he took off and did a solo nonstop. You may have heard about that. That was about a year or so he got back. So it may have started with a step, if it's the same guy, and I think it is. So anyway, moving right along, I'll get out of that one. You can also follow Trekker's blurb and Builder's blog. Now, Pitor is doing a great job. He's just finished fairing the hull with micro balloons. It'll get turned over very soon and they'll start working on the deck. But Janice is doing a great job of actually doing the description. So Pitor's building, taking the photos. Janice is doing the description. There's stuff going up virtually every week now, so if you want to follow that. And there's some other cool builders' blogs as well. And one of them, I won't say which one, but some of them are really cool. One, the guy's done a full 3D model of the boat. You can get on and download the program very simply. You just hit it and it downloads. And you can rotate the boat. You can look at it at all different angles and so on. And there's another one here, which is my favorite shot. Another one of my favorite shots. Here it is. One of the builders couldn't work out where to actually build the boat, so he organized a party tent. This is like a garden party tent, and he's rigged that. You can see he's got the building frame there ready to not the boat frame, but the building frame, the foundation to stand your frames and so on. And so he's got a party marquee in the garden just out the back door, and he's quite happy. So that's an interesting way to do it. So you see more and more now the actual builders coming online. It's taken them a long time to get the gear organized, get set up, but it's all happening. So one of the things I want to talk about is spars and rigs. We've got my spar, Sparcraft rig, is just about finished. It'll be finished next week. And we're also talking to Selden about a situation there. And we're also, as you know, looking at different sections being approved in other countries around the world. It's a process to go through that. We've only had one that's actually making an application at the moment. But one thing I wanted to point out about masts is that if you, it ties in with the sails. The sails are a set size. All the sails are going to be identical. And the sails are designed to go on the standard rig plan that you've got for hanks, okay? And if you're going to fit a furler on the headstay, which I did, your headsail won't fit because the luff is standard size. And you're going to lose luff length with your drum. You're going to lose luff length at the top of your swivel and so on. That means your attachment point to the mast is going to have to be further up. In other words, your forestay is going to have to be longer. That has other ramifications because your capture rods have to attach at about the same spot. So there's going to be some modifications to your rig. So what we'll be establishing, and you're quite able to do that because you've got minimum strength and so on, but if you need to lift your forestay a bit higher, that's fine. But we're going to have a process where you'll actually be registering your rig. And also it goes with your sails, which we'll explain more about that a bit later on. So just be aware of the fact that the sails are fixed. They're a set size. If you're going to put a furler on, then you've got to make sure it fits. So don't rush out and order your rig based on the existing plan because that's set up for hank sails. What else have we got? The other thing with Selden's situation is what we've done. Selden don't normally sell sections for you to build your own mast, okay? That's the bottom line. And some of the places around the world may not have the smaller size for the 580. So what we're going to do is we're actually going to buy a bundle of masts, okay, in batches of five, and they'll be complete. It'll be all the standard rigging, all your running rigging, everything's done on the mast, but it's basically disassembled. You've got the sleeve, you pull it apart, and we'll literally be able to come up with a really good price to provide a mast, just lost a light there, and buy a mast in a tube. They've been exported anywhere in the world, all right? And we're just working on that now. The plan is when we launch Trekker to do sea trials and test everything, we'll actually put Sparcraft rig on, do all that. We'll take that off. We'll put the Selden rig on, the kit rig, which will be made up, and check everything with that as well. Then that will come off, put in the tube, and we'll actually be able to give you a price. And it's looking like it's going to be very competitive. So we're buying bulk, we're buying as OEM, and standby for that. So there's a few things happening with rigs right now. The sales situation is looking really good. As you know, we're going to go with a one design sale supplier for 5 years, and that'll all be the first set for trials being manufactured now. We're actually hoping to be sailing around middle of September, but we're waiting for them to build the sales and make sure everything's set so that we can check all that, make sure everything's settled, and then we'll actually announce it either the end of this month or very early next month. Generally, the spec is really high, and I won't say much more than that, otherwise, other than the fact that they're tri-radial sales, they're partially fully battened. It's the best of everything. We're really I think everyone should be quite impressed. Very high spec on that. But let's wait and see. We'll be establishing on the One Design sales section of the website the full specification there and a full explanation. So when we announce it, you'll be able to check out there and see what's going on. The other issue with that is that the section that that are approved at the moment this is actually sections for Sparcraft, and you'll see it's generally a box section. Let's just call it a box section. I'm using the S67. You can use the S50 if you want to. But then alongside that, what we're doing, the standard spec sales, we'll actually have Rutgerson fittings. And it's not the actual one, but it's a similar car, runs up in that track. And these little wheels, you'll see little wheels either side, actually run on the trailing edge of the mast section. Okay, so the sale is specced up for Rutgerson, compression slides and cars and lots of stuff. So it works really well, right? Especially if it's that section. So if you just bear that in mind for a minute, if you've got a set of plans, which most people here may have a set of plans, here's another option. This is a teardrop section mast. So you can see at the bottom of this picture, it's half of the teardrop section. Another a very good, very solid, quite capable, inexpensive mast section that you can get in various countries. But when you use that section, you won't be able to use the cars running on tracks in the middle. You'd just be using standard sail slugs, not bolt rope. You'd still have slugs so you can drop the sail and it's connected to the bluff. But that's another consideration. It's another reason why we need to register the rigs so that we know exactly what rig you've got, exactly what the connections are for your forestay and caps and so on, so that when it comes time to order your sails, which will be registered individually through us, we get all that, we can make sure they match up and there's no confusion. So just bear in mind, both the Selden and the Sparcraft sections are those box section concepts, and there's one other spar maker who makes spars for all the 650s. Well, that's another interesting point too. That is a box section and it'll run the Rutgerson cars. So just be aware of that. That's another aspect. So there'll be a lot coming out on rigs in the next couple of weeks as well. Okay, now the stainless steel bits. This is for you would have all been given a notice. If you've bought plans, you've been given notice about the stainless steel components and so on. This is your actual stem head fitting. I'm using this as an example. There's a couple of things. First of all, in fact, I'll talk about this one specifically. You'll see it's a simple chain plate, three holes at the top, very broad, quite solid. It's bent back to the angle of the forestay. If you're setting up with a furling gear or a single forestay, you use the middle pin. If you're setting up twins, you can use the outer holes. But the stainless steel box welded to the front of it takes the timber bowsprit. This is mandatory, so to speak. And coming with the stainless steel gear is another box, a stainless steel box like that, or a tube that you'll weld underneath the stainless steel component of the bowsprit that you make. So that's all supplied as well. I just want to explain how it works, because there's a 33% discount if you order your stainless steel package in the first month, which expires at the end of this month. The reason for that is it's like a cooperative buying thing. We're actually buying 50 sets of this stuff. They're individually numbered, and you have a chance to save money, because we're going to spend a lot of money to buy this stuff, and if you just put your money up front, you get it through, and you're buying at the same price we are. If you're not buying it in this batch of 50, the first 50 plan holders, the price goes up, and basically you don't get your 33% discount anymore. So you've got until the end of the month to make that decision if you want them now. After that, you can buy them anytime, but the price will be completely different. So we're doing that to encourage people to join the group, join the team, and we can save a lot of money doing it, and we don't have our money hanging out while it happens. So, and there's been a few modifications of the drawings too. We've modified the inner forestay chain plate. One of the builders brought up a point about sealing, so we've got a flange on that now. We're getting good feedback on the forum, so that's just a bit of an update there. Okay, where do we go? Well, we sent a press release out. You may have read it, you know, and you met two of our female builders, Alenka in from Australia, and also Mathilde from France. I thought you'd like this picture. This is Mathilde's, the little boat on its side there. It's Mathilde. That's the boat she already owns. She's been training on that. Her father is a sailing instructor. Sailing is in her blood and in the whole family. But you like the car? Of course, you had to have a Mini. So anyway, I thought that was cool. So she's got this one, but she's now building her 580, but I thought that was a bit of a giggle. We will get builders on. The sailors on, that's going to be quite a thing. I think we'll do it two at a time when we do this, and we might start that in the next couple of weeks. We're really busy at the moment. There's a hell of a lot going on, but as soon as we settle down a bit, it'll be a bit of fun, so you can get to meet the people, find out why they're doing it and what they're up to. But that's cool. We've had some interesting questions on the forum about the situation with outboards. Now basically what's going to happen is I've got another here. Okay, this is all the rage. This is a reality, and it means that you will not be able to use a petrol motor on any of the major events like the Transat or the Mini Globe race or even the even our championship in Portugal sailing down the coast. We've done that on purpose. Electric outboards are the way of the future, and it just saves, it's a lot safer. You don't have petrol on the boat. It's not cheap. Electric outboards are, not cheap. That's the bottom line. They are okay. I've been following them for a long time, and I think their time has come. But there'll be more choice. This one's the torpedo or whatever. There's a couple of others around. I'm yet to decide what I'm going to use. I think I'm using a different one. I'm not using this one probably. We're going through the process of determining what size is going to be, because we don't want to use one of the little fishing ones, and it'll probably be set up once we do sea trials. Again, we'll make the decision. It'll probably be a minimum of 3 horsepower, equivalent of 3 horsepower, and a maximum of 5 horsepower. So that's what you're going to need if you're going to enter one of the major 580 events. If you're just going micro cruising for the weekend, you can use what you like. You know, we don't care. But in our event, that's the reality. Now, here comes the next interplay, and this is very interesting because it goes like this. When our major events are on, which is the Transat and the Mini Globe race, you'll be able to use that motor whenever you want. But if there's a calm, you can turn your outboard on and go, right? You're not allowed to row. We're not going to allow human power. If we allowed human power, basically – you'd see all sorts of things. You'd see muscle builders coming up. They'd be setting up huge oars. They'd be setting up looking at bikes with pedals to try and maximise the human element of pushing the boat. Now, it's not on. We're not going to do that, so you won't be able to use human power to propel your boat during the event, but you will be able to use the electric outboard, and you can see what that's going to open up. And the first thing is some people get shocked, but it gets quite interesting. The other point is that you won't be able to use the electric outboard for the first 12 hours of the start of the Transat. After that, you can use it whenever you want. And so that brings in, people can have solar panels, and you can have batteries on board, and you can charge your outboard using your solar panels. There will be restrictions. The maximum capacity, battery capacity, allowed on board is going to be 165 amp hours, and they must be gel cells or AGM batteries. There's no lithium batteries. When you buy your outboard, you can have a maximum of one spare battery pack. So you can have your lithium batteries, obviously, so you have a proprietary brand name, one spare battery pack. Solar panels, you must have a minimum of 50 watts, but the maximum is capped, I think, at 195 watts. So you won't be able to carry any more solar panels than that. And so that makes some interesting management issues there, which may be advantageous if you get a lot of calms, so on. And it will interplay it will be a big part of the Mini Globe race, the pit stops and so on. But that'll all be explained in the notice of race for the Mini Globe race when we release that in November this year. Notice of race for the Transat will be out hopefully in August. Next month we should be able to put the pre-notice race out. And that's all going extremely well. You may have noticed, if you're following the Transat Facebook page, that we've already announced that we do have subsidised shipping. That's a good deal. So the most you're likely to pay for the container ride to bring your boat back to the home port where it started is going to be €1,300. In fact, it's a little bit less than that. It could be as low as $1,200 or $1,150, $1,200, something like that. So we're saying at the moment, count on about €1,300 for a euro for your trip back from the end of the race if you want to take up that offer. And now we're in discussions about trying to assess the total number that we can provide free shipping back. From an organiser's perspective, from my perspective, I'd like to offer that to the first 10 boats home. But it might be the first six. It depends. It all comes down to sponsors and partners, but we're in the process of that at the moment. We're very close to how can I put this? Let's just say within 2 months, we will be announcing our home port, a start port, and also either Madeira or Lanzarote. Okay, but it's going really well. And there's some exciting things planned, so stay tuned for that. We hope to see everyone getting interested. We've got people just starting to build boats now, and they're in a rush to get there. So that'll be kind of cool. What I was going to tell you about the Transat. That's it. Oh, now the other thing is, get rid of this one. It might sound like a strange comment, but wind vanes, any wind vane you like, will be compulsory for the 580 Transat, and also for the Mini Globe Race, obviously. So it will be compulsory to have a wind vane. And there's a few smaller units out there that you can use. I'm using the South Atlantic. They're supporting the 580 class, so if you're up for a South Atlantic wind vane, there's a special discount code. You get in touch with the supplier, and it's got a custom bracket. Everything's there. Just put it on the back of the boat and go. So I'm happy with that. I made the decision after I did it. He said, "What's this 580?" And he agreed that he'd offer some support to all the entrants and sort of help partner with the class. So you must have a wind vane. But here's the next issue. And you can actually obviously build your own wind vane, and I'll bring up something about that in a minute. So you don't have to buy a commercial one if you don't want one. So then with autopilots, we're allowing one cockpit autopilot in there. But again, coming from the forum, some interesting discussions there. It's always meant to be a standalone filler pilot. So with these three models here, I think they're Simrad, with these three models, the smallest one at the top is probably the most basic, and if it is Simrad, it'll be the A10 or something, or T10. It's a standalone. All you do is put power to it, and everything associated with the pilot is in that little unit. The next one down is interfacing. It interfaces with GPS, and interface with your wind instrument, all those things, they're not allowed, okay? It's got to be a standalone one, and Raymarine have huge ones. You know, they have ones with readouts and all sorts of rubbish, all sorts of stuff, which is great. They're on the boats, bigger boats. But we're keeping it simple. It has to be just a standalone autopilot. So just be aware of that. Vanes are compulsory, so that's cool. And so that then brings in another one. I've had a few people contacting me. As you know, I'm in the seniors division. So if you're over 60, there's a seniors division, which is kind of cool. And if you're below 60, you just sail with the rest of the fleet. But I've had a few people saying, "Oh, look, you know, there's a difference. You know, some of us are building our own boats, everything ourselves. Others are getting them built, whatever. Some have got sponsors, some haven't. You know, some don't want sponsors and so on." So it's just a discussion point for now, but it's been suggested we could have a classic division, which would be boats that have at least 50% of the construction and everything built by the owners, okay, and there's no electric autopilot, right? You just have to have a wind vane. You can buy or build a wind vane, and there might be some other things, and you'd have to be Corinthian as well. Just to add that little slant to make it a different type of division, that would mean anyone else like me, but I'm in the seniors, so it doesn't matter, but someone who hasn't built their own boat or hasn't built the majority of it or wants all you'd be in the modern division. I'm not saying we're going to do it, but it's an interesting discussion. So that's kind of cool. I think I've got some other pictures here. I think, guys, some we mentioned previously about buying an Astrodome. These are clear ones. They're made in Poland. They're 200 euro from the factory. And if we got eight, we could do a smoky grey one, like tinted grey off the hatch acrylic. I've used domes plenty of times before. I'm a BOC Challenge boat. I had one. It was always the tinted grey, and it's a little bit more subtle than having a clear one. So if you want one, let us know, because I'm about to order. And once I order, the offer's all over. Anyone can buy a clear one. We've got four people. We can order four. We need to order eight. So it's in Poland. It's 200 euro. If we get to eight in the next 10 days, we can do it. Otherwise, that deal is off. We'll see the factory that makes them in Poland. You can contact them yourself if you want one. You might be able to get one in your own country, but that was a way of getting a smoky grey one, which is kind of cool. Let's see. Now, I think that just about covers it. So I'm just looking through my points here. Yeah, I've covered off on most of the stuff. Okay, so another question we had, like, I really like the Setkas, and I think you all know, you know, this was part of the history of these boats. You know, when I was coming up with the idea of doing what we're doing, was to, you know, make all the features we wanted, but, you know, not lose any of the aspects of the Setkas. But we are completely different in many ways. But someone asked a question a month or so ago, because the Setkas are also running a solo transatlantic race, which was this year, but the pandemic shut it down, so they're running it next year. It'll probably start a little bit ahead of us. The suggestion was, or the question was, could the Setkas join our event? Like, have a Setka division and a 580 division. And the short story is it's really difficult and we couldn't do it. These are the Setkas from 2006. When was this? This was the last one in 2000. When was that? I forget. 18. 2019, beginning of 19. Anyway, this was South Portugal where they set off from. As it turns out, I don't want to say too much because we haven't made any announcements yet. We're not starting now from South Portugal. We're actually starting way further north. Okay. So it's a bit further. We have different elements to our boats versus the Setka. Nothing, it's just that we're different and it's very hard to mix them. We do a lot of stuff with coordinating with governments and safety regulations and all sorts of standards, you know, which adds cost. And the beauty and the simplicity of the Setka is it gets rid of all that stuff. And I relate to that, believe me. It's just that once I put my neck on the line to organise an event and play the game, I have to make sure that we do all this other stuff. And so we don't want to, you know, I really love the Setkas and I think they're a class on their own. And if you can't afford to build a 580, have a look at the Setka. That's the bottom line. So we wish them well. And we've got a lot of mates in there. And Victor is building my boat. He's already got his boat. He did the last one, his Setka, Atom. And he's going to go again. So anyway, so he'll be, you know, we'll be hanging out a bit. And he's coming down to help me sail a boat as well. Might have forgotten how to sail a little boat. So Pitor's going to come down with the boat from Holland down to La Sable d'Olonne in France. That's where we're going to try and do the sea trials. We've got a one-month window to do the sea trials between the middle of September and the middle of October, because then the Vendée boats come in and the whole port gets locked down. No one can move. So we've got to work to that timeline. But I'm looking forward to that. It'll be quite a bit of fun. So I think that's about it. Nothing more to say. There's no questions here. That's really about it, yeah. So thanks for that. And next time around, we'll look to include some entrants, I think. That'll be a bit of fun. I lost myself there. I pressed the wrong button, so some people have probably already signed off. Anyway, so yeah, we'll look forward to it next time. And in the meantime, thanks for following the Class Globe 580. It's been cool. See you later.